Hello everyone. So this is GS Mains paper 2, November 2016-17, sorry, part 6, and this is the last part, right? After that, we move on to GS Mains paper 3. We are running behind schedule, right? So let's start. So we have done up until 24 topics, right? So the 25th topic is India State Level Disease Burden Report. Now, the thing is, this report is in news. It has been covered by Big Picture. It was in news in AIR. So what is this report? Who publishes this report? And who published this report? See, again, the thing is, it is important from prelims point of view, and this India State Level Disease Burden Report, who published, is important from prelims point of view. The whole report which will be, what do you say, reading right now, no? That is important from mains point of view. So the thing is, it is a joint initiative of ICMR, that is Indian Council of Medical Research, Public Health Foundation of India, PHFI, and experts from over 100 institutions in collaboration with Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So lots and lots of stakeholders are involved here in an India State Level Disease Burden Report, right? But the main cog of this particular report, or the main institution, is ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, right? Another thing is, they have talked about something called DALY, that is Disability Adjusted Life Year. Now, what is DALY? So it is sum of number of years of life lost due to premature death and a weighted measure of years lived with disability due to a disease or an injury. So this is DALY, that is whatever number of years a people has lost due to premature death or because of some disability. So all these things, and a summation of all these things, will give you DALY, that is disability adjusted life year, right? Now the thing is, per person disease burden measured as DALY rate has dropped in India by 36% from 1990 to 2016. But major inequalities are there among states, right? So the thing is, this DALY has reduced by 36% from 1990 to 2016, but there are major variation among states, right? Now the thing is, diarrheal disease, lower respiratory infections, iron deficiency, anemia, neonatal disorder. What is neonatal? That is relating to newborn children. And TB still continue to be a major public health problem in many poorer northern states. So diarrheal disease, respiratory infection, iron deficiency, neonatal disorder, TB, all these are major public health problems. But the thing is, child and maternal undernutrition, it is still the single largest risk factor in India, responsible for 15% of total disease burden in 2016. So child and maternal undernutrition. So this is the single largest risk factor in our country. What is the second largest risk factor? Air pollution levels in India is among the highest in the world, making it second leading risk factor in 2016, responsible for 10% of total disease burden. So all these things, why we are talking about this particular report? Because all these findings will add in decentralized health planning, because each and every state will be knowing what they have to do. So center will not be doing everything, right? So again, state will also take some of the initiatives, right? So this will help in decentralized health planning. Fine. So I think this whole report is clear to you. Just remember the basic thing, basic gist: child and maternal undernutrition and air pollution, two biggest cause of total disease burden in India, according to India State Level Disease Burden Report. Now let's move on to the next topic, that is PIL, Collegium System and MoP. Now the thing is, what is happening in recent years, PIL has become a space, or interstitial space, in which judges give policy directives. Interstitial space means a small opening. So judges have got this particular opening, and by this they are doing the work which ideally should be done by executive and legislature, right? So they are doing it, and they should not be doing it. So the thing is, PIL should not become an interstitial space in which judges give policy directives. Now the thing is, present collegium system is flawed and it lacks transparency, and there is a clear need to have a better and more credible process in making judicial appointment. So that is the need of the hour, and we are continuously talking about this thing. But there are certain differences between judiciary and executive. And what are those differences over? So differences over formulating a fresh MOP, that is memorandum procedure for appointment, are casting a shadow on relationship between executive and judiciary. Now the thing is, what is the way forward? The way forward is, both executive and judiciary should disclose points of difference, and they should have a quick resolution, because if they keep on delaying it, it will serve neither's purpose, and it would be detrimental for our country as a whole, right? So that is the whole thing. Fine. Now let's talk about ILO's goal of, what is ILO's? International Labour Organization. And what is it? Is it a UN agency, non-UN agency? What is it? So it is a UN agency. It also takes into care all the complaints against what is it, international mandate and everything, but it doesn't impose any sanction on government. So do remember, ILO, generally what happens, whatever UN agency you have, it generally starts from UN, UNESCO and all those things. But even though ILO has no UN prefix or suffix attached to it, but still ILO is a UN agency, right? So the ILO has a goal of eradicating child labor by 2025. But that particular goal now seems elusive, and there are two major reasons for it. First is absence of national legislation to give effect to global conventions on employment of children in hazardous industries, as well as on the minimum age of work. In certain areas, minimum age of children is 18, somewhere 15, somewhere 12. In African countries, sub-Saharan Africa, the age is lesser. So that is the whole thing. So there's no global consensus on what should be the minimum age of work. Similarly, there's absence of national legislation. So all these things are creating a hindrance. And that's why ILO has said that this goal of eradicating child labor by 2025 seems elusive. So that was the first major reason. What was the second reason? The second reason is lack of effective labor inspection in informal economy. So that is the second reason, right? So that is lack of effective labor inspection in informal economy. So I hope this whole thing is clear to you, right? Fine. Now let's move on to the next topic. Now, OECD's PISA and India's public school system. What is OECD? Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, right? The thing is, what is PISA? PISA is Program for International Student Assessment, and OECD is publishing it. Now, this is a triennial survey. Triennial means once in 3 years. So it is a triennial survey of assessment of 15-year-old in reading, maths and science. So by this particular survey, they are understanding whether a particular education system is flawed or not, right? So that is a way to deduce it, right? Now, the thing is, what has happened here? India is a terrible underperformer in this. And why is this happening? Because of certain issues with our health means education system, right? Now, what has happened? Inobservable shift to private sector education along with Right to Education Act represents a failure of public school system. Right now, what do our parents say? Our parents say, study in private school, but if you want to be an engineer, do engineering from a public college or government college, right? So that is the whole. This whole thing sums up the education system of our country. Primary education is suffering a lot. So we have to, what do you say? Government has to impart more money in the primary sector as well, primary education as well, as they are doing in secondary and higher education, right? Tertiary sector. So that is the whole thing. Now the thing is, government schools should be the drivers of change by becoming the first, not the last choice of parents to send their children to. And it is now time that India began viewing school education as a critical strategic investment and gave it the status of a vital infrastructure project. Now the school education should be given a vital infrastructure project status. Now we have seen all those things. Government is assigning infrastructure status to different domains, right? So same thing they can do to school education also. Now, radical overhaul with the help of countries that have an amazing record in providing quality education, we can take that. We can take help from those countries which has an amazing record in providing quality school education. And what is an example? Finland is a great example of it. Finland has done amazingly well in primary education, in school education, and we can take help from those countries. And it's not like they won't help us, right? So we can always take their help, and that should be the way forward. Fine. Now let's talk about some one-liners. Now let's talk about diabetes effect on women. Now the thing is, diabetes is not like it's not affecting men, but the effect on women is much more pronounced and much more hazardous, right? Now diabetes affects around 70 million people in India, 70 million people in India, and it is now a near epidemic, with women among nearly half of those who are affected, right? So 50% of diabetes patients in India are women, right? Approximately 50%. Now the thing is, women with diabetes may face many problems mentally and physically. So that's why when diabetes effect on man and women both are pronounced, but on women, there are some mental effects also, or mental issues also, which comes along with diabetes. So they have to take proper care of it. So that is about diabetes effect on women. And sometimes these mental stigma, people don't care about it, and it leads to something else altogether. So proper attention needs to be given, right? Now let's talk about global hunger index. From prelims point of view, what is important is who publishes it. So it is published by IFPRI and other bodies, right? So IFPRI is one of the major bodies. And what is IFPRI? International Food Policy Research Institute, right? And it is an international agriculture research center, which is headquartered in Washington, if I'm not wrong, US, right? So Global Hunger Index is published by IFPRI and other bodies. And what is the rank of India? India is ranked 100 out of 119 countries, worse than Myanmar, Bangladesh and Iraq. So we are even worse than Bangladesh in Global Hunger Index, right? So that means only ease of doing business will not do. We have to do well in all these kind of hunger index also. But again, people also talk about that. There was a Niti Aayog article where they have talked about that global hunger index is flawed because they are giving too much attention to child malnutrition, and India has a significantly small population of child, so it is not giving a correct data. But there again was a counter article which we'll talk about in future videos, right? So that is the whole thing. Instead of trying to find loopholes in each and everything, now we have to look inside ourselves and we have to rectify all these errors, right? Fine. So this was about GS Mains Paper 2 November 2017. We'll start GS Mains Paper 3 now. Fine. Thank you.